Hello, welcome to my talk behind the scenes of the OBS team. So, Anko already did the joke yesterday with that he feels like a rock star. I'm just relieved that I don't need to carry the microphone, the beverage, and the ticker, because yesterday at the lightning talks, everyone was shouting at you as soon as you put your beverage somewhere. So I'm just happy. So behind the scenes of the OBS talk team, that is Leo the Lion, that is behind the scenes of the MGM video shooting. So every MGM movie what you see the Lion at the beginning, and that is from I think 90 years ago how they shoot it, this. So to just quickly bring everyone up to speed, OBS is our distribution build system, what we have at OpenSUSE and at SUSE. So every package and every appliance or ISO image what you install is built by OBS. So it's a way to build packages for different output systems like RPM or DBN. You can build different images like ISO images or images for the cloud or even containers. So OBS is basically, that is just a very easy overview how OBS is constructed. So you have a front end, which is basically the API and the web interface, what you as a user usually use to talk to OBS. And then you have a back end, which is which contains different services like a source service and rep service and workers, which do the actual build job. And the front end uses a database and a cache. But there are also subsystems for the front end. For instance, the what we recently introduced is application health monitoring, or the RabbitMQ bus what we introduced last year. So that are some subsystems. I'm just mentioning that because later on it will be important how we set up our development environment, and why we do it like we do it is because of the setup. So the OBS team, so we are basically responsible for development of the front end, so the API and the web interface, and we are also responsible for deploying our reference installation built OpenSUSE.org. Most people of you probably use when you package. Sorry? So yeah, so we are responsible for build OpenSUSE.org and for the development. So our team is, so we are all hired by SUSE, so we are working full-time at the build service. We are a distributed team, so all our meetings happen in online and GoToMeeting. That was last week at our stand-up meeting in the morning. So I'm in the right corner, and David is also here. So we are a distributed team, so all communication happens online. And we are distributed to two different locations. So we have some developers sitting in Nuremberg in our SUSE office, and we have some developers sitting in Gran Canaria. Basically we are only distributed to two different locations. So the next few minutes, I just want to talk a little bit about our workflow. So how we organize our work, how we work together, how we decide on what we work. And it's basically, so we do not decide what we, so we do not wake up in the morning and decide, okay, we implement this feature. It's more or less, it's coming from the users. So they will create an issue in GitHub, or they will create a fate request that they want a feature implemented, or they want an issue fixed. And then our we are organized in Scrum. That means Scrum is an agile methodology, and our product owner prioritizes all the issues and the feature requests, and then he decides what we will do in our next sprint. And then we start development. So after development, we have some automated tests to make sure that we do not introduce regressions, that the code quality is right. After that, we do a review. So we do at least a peer review. Often, even more than one additional team member needs to review it. And the last step is we ship it to build OpenSUSE.org. So that is, for us, very important that we try to deploy as often as possible. So to talk a little bit more about Scrum, so we use basically Scrum by the book. So we have 2-week sprints. We have a planning meeting at the beginning of the sprint where we sit together with our product owner and talk about what we want to do the next 2 weeks. We have at the end of the sprint, we have a review meeting where we show what we did the last 2 weeks to our users and also to our product owner. And we have the usual artifacts like a product backlog and a sprint backlog. So in talking more about the meetings, so we try to make the review meeting, or we do the review meeting public. So we usually send an email to, at the moment, only to our internal SUSE mailing list, and we invite people from other teams to join and see what we did and give us feedback. We also talked about recently that we want to try to make it in general public so that people who not work at SUSE and are from the community can also join and our review meetings and give us feedback. So in what also happened the last few years is that we hired a lot of new developers. So in the beginning, there were only one, then we started to hire 2 new people. So at the moment we are 6, and next month we will, or the next 2 months, 3 new team members will join. And with a big project like OBS, it's really hard to bring them up to speed. So what we often do is mob programming. So that means the whole team sits together and works on the same problem. So for one afternoon or 2 hours or something, we sit together, talk about what we need to implement, and then somebody opens the editor and everyone works together on the same problem. And that really helped to share knowledge, to bring people up to speed, and it's also really fun. Then often during the sprint, so it's the main feature, or one feature of Scrum, is that you have encapsulated 2 weeks where you cannot get interrupted and you can focus on the work. But sometimes you have work which cannot wait for 2 weeks. So we introduced a role of demolition squad, which rotates every week. So one person of the team is responsible for the demolition squad, is taking care of, for instance, security issues coming up or dependency updates, deploying our reference installation, taking care of exceptions which happen on our build OpenSUSE installation. And yeah, at the beginning when we started, so we did 2 persons work together in the demolition squad, so one more experienced team member, one not so experienced, and then after a while we started that only one person does it and we rotate it every week. So, and it turned out to be really useful, so especially for deployment and stuff like that. And speaking about deployment, we do continuous delivery, which means every commit what we do is potentially can deploy to production. That doesn't mean that we deploy every commit to production. We try to deploy as often as possible. We try to deploy every day, but it doesn't happen automatically. So somebody in the team needs to trigger deployment manually. So that is something what we even want to improve more in the future and automate it even more, so that we, with every commit to master, we deploy our instance, but that is not the case at the moment. And if you're curious what when was the last deployment or which version we are running, so you can go to buildopensuse.org/about, and then we just recently introduced it, the last deployment, and you see the date, and it is, so you see, I just checked it before the talk, so the last deployment was on Friday morning. And you also see the commit hash, so you can go to GitHub and you can check if, maybe if you send a pull request, if it's already deployed, and check what version or what commit hash is on master and which is deployed. So that was mainly about the workflow. In the next few minutes, I will a little bit talk about our tools and what tools we use and why we use them. So, as I already mentioned, the artifacts what we have in Scrum is basically a sprint backlog and a product backlog, and we organize it in Trello. So in SUSE in general, Trello is heavily used, which is it's a Kanban board, which allows you to have different lanes and you can create cards. And then the cards, we have the user stories written down, and then you see here, for instance, we have the to be done or the sprint backlog, which means that is what we work in the next 2 weeks. Then we have the doing lane. When somebody starts to work on it, we move it to doing, and when it's done, then it goes to review, and then it goes to done. So that about Trello and containers. So you saw in the beginning how OBS is structured. So you have the front and the back end, you have a database and a cache and then some subsystems. So it was really hard for development to set it up. So when you started, if you want to hack something, it was really complicated to set it up. So we first started to have a Vagrant box. So Vagrant is just a command line tool to manage virtual machines. So we started to do that and it worked really nice, and we had it, I think, for more than 1 year. And last year, we started to use containers, so we switched to Docker. And to be honest, at the beginning, I was a little bit concerned, and I was not sure if this is the right movement, but looking back now, it was really, really good decision, because it makes so easy to plug in more stuff like the RabbitMQ bus. You just have another Docker Compose file, and you apply it on the default Docker Compose file, and then you have the RabbitMQ running. So it's super easy to plug in more stuff. So every part of the application, what I mentioned in the beginning, the backend and the database and everything, is a single container, and you just spin it up. And also, if you mess up your development environment, you just destroy it and start it again. So it's super easy and super convenient. And so in the other talk what we had this morning, so we already introduced the Docker registry what we have now. So all the containers what we use for continuous integration are already built in OBS. The containers what we use in development are built on Docker Hub, but that we will switch the next few weeks. So that is, we will switch completely to OBS built images. So in speaking about the code, we use GitHub. So everything is organized in GitHub. We use mostly issues. So if you find an issue or if you have a feature request, then please go to GitHub and file an issue. And as said, we have a review. So somebody of the team, if you send a pull request, somebody of the team needs to review it. And you also see we work quite a lot with labels. So we have different labels so that you already see it at the first glance. Okay, this pull request is relevant for me, or I need to review it. So that is really heavily used. And we also use GitHub status for pull requests. So you see here different states of the, or different services which run on the pull request and report if it's safe to merge this pull request. For instance, we have Akiri for security issues, which scans your Ruby application and scans it for dependencies and issues and reports if there's some potential security issues. We had code coverage, which checks if you introduce new code, if it's covered by tests or if you're decreasing the code coverage. And we use Travis for continuous integration. So Travis is an hosted service for continuous integration. And what we use there is, it's a beta feature, it's build stages, which is really cool. So you have different stages of your continuous integration process. So the first stage for us is linting, which means some LubuCorp, for instance, runs and makes sure that all the code styles are applied. And that we do because you only have a certain amount of build jobs at the same time. So If the first build stage fails, the other build stages do not start. So that means we do not pollute our build queue. And then we have four more build stages, or four more continuous integration runs. So it's one is for every test suite what we have, one run gets run. And what Travis does basically, it starts for every build stage at Ubuntu box. And that had some, we had some issues because we needed to package especially for Ubuntu to make the Travis run. And also, Ubuntu is not a supported system from us, so it didn't make sense to test on Ubuntu if it's actually not supported. So, and what we did is we switched also to containers, and we run in on the Ubuntu box. We run now our Slay containers, which we built in OBS. So we built in Travis on an Ubuntu box. We run Docker containers, which run our tests. And so we just did it a few weeks ago, and it started that the test suite takes longer. So can somebody imagine why it takes longer? Somebody, some idea? So so the issue was we didn't run all tests in Ubuntu because we had the test suite. It was checking the base system if it's less or if it's OpenSUSE, and if not, then it skipped the test. So we looked at it, or when we had the pull request, we figured out, okay, it takes 5 minutes more, and it cannot be just because it runs in a container, but it was because we skipped some tests. So, yeah. Then the frontend is a Rails application, so we heavily rely on Lua gems. So, and we use Depfoo, which is a hosted service which automatically sends a pull request as soon as your dependency updates. So it checks frequently if there's an update of a dependency, sends a pull request, and you see in the pull request that only one gem gets updated, and you even get the release notes, and you see what does change. And that is really nice, because before we just once in a while we updated the dependencies, and then you had 20 changes, and if something broke, you don't know what is going on. So, and we even automated it a little bit more because we need to repackage all the gems in OBS to make it installable on OpenSUSE or on the appliance. So we automated here that it checks if the package is already in OBS. If it's in OBS, which version is it? And if not, what command you need to execute to update the version. So, for instance, the first one is it's already up to date in the dev project. You need to execute a setlink ref to update the link. But then, yeah, as already mentioned, we make use of commands and peer review. And what we also recently introduced is review apps. So review apps are disposable apps which run the code of your pull request. So when you create a pull request, we have a label. You can append the label a review app, and it will spin up automatically an app with the code of the pull request. And that is really nice for UI changes, because usually we work a lot with screenshots, and you attach screenshots, and then developers usually are lazy, so you don't check out the code. You look at the screenshot and say, "Ah, okay, it's fine," and look at the code. But sometimes it's really useful, or you really want to check out the workflow or check what changed. And for that, review apps are really awesome. That is, we implemented traffic. That is some reverse proxy, which so we just check out the pull request, run Docker or build the Docker container, spin them up, and then the traffic reverse proxy makes sure that that it gets linked to a different URL. So after pull request is merged, we build an appliance, so like a VirtualBox image or an ISO image, and the last step, or almost last step, is we test it in OpenQA. So we do a smoke test. So we spin up the appliance, log in, start the server, build a package in the server, and check if this works. So we do a full integration and actually build a package and check if it works. And as we also take care of the built OpenSUSE instance, we use Airbit to make sure if we deploy something and exceptions are happening, that we realize what exceptions are happening and that we can create issues right away from Airbit and make sure that we can deploy a fix. So that was it about tooling. Now talking a little bit about community. So we have a blog in openbuildservice.org and we frequently release blog articles. And one thing what we also do is we write postmortems. So when we deploy and sometimes something goes wrong, so we sit all together in the team and we really try to knock down what went wrong. So we ask, why did it happen? And a few times, why did it happen? What did we wrong? And how we can make sure in the future that it doesn't happen again. So that was really beneficial for us to improve our workflow, to improve our tooling. And also, I think it's nice for the community and the users so that they also know what is going on and what did we wrong. And maybe even they don't do the same mistake what we did. And we also release every 2 weeks when the sprint is done, we release a sprint summary. So we write down what we did the last 2 weeks, and it's actually one part of our acceptance criteria of a sprint card is that you add something to our sprint report. So the whole team works on it, so we have a document, and then everyone adds his stuff, what he did, to the document, and at the end of the 2 weeks, somebody takes care to release it and sums it up and makes it nice. So, except that, we have the OpenSUSE Build Service channel, we have OBS headquarter at Twitter, where we usually also retweet when we have a blog article released, and we have the mailing list built OpenSUSE.org. That is basically what I wanted to tell you, what I wanted to show you, and if you have questions, I'm happy to answer it. Yeah, Matthias.
So, first of all, I would like to ask, who is the product owner? Because you told him, and
The product owner is Adrian Schröder. Oh, it's a shared role. It's Adrian Schröder and Michael Schröder. So they share the product owner role together. Mm-hmm. So, yeah. So they are both working at SUSE.
And they prioritize the issues. And
exactly.
And so the second question is, how do you plan to automate the deployment?
Sorry?
The deployment, how do you plan to automate it and to make it, because you said it was manually?
Yeah, it's manually. It's done by RPM packages, and the reason is that's also how we deliver it to our customers. So you can install OBS, or to our customers, users, so you can install OBS on your server if you want to. We deliver it as an RPM, and that is just the drink your own champagne or eat your own dog food approach, that we also install RPM packages. How we want to automate it more, that is to be discussed, so that is not decided yet, but yeah. What? Yeah, but we don't want to use containers at the moment because of several reasons. For instance, we only use containers in development and CI now for the front end. the backend is completely different. So what I was talking about deployment was only about the web interface and the API. So, and we do not want to deploy it different than the rest of the application. So because the backend is also completely or is deployed by RPMs. If we switch only the front end, then the front end would be deployed different and the backend different. That is one thing what we want to avoid. In general, switching to containers for production is probably nothing what we will do the next year. So it was actually, we thought about it and we talked about it and researched in this area, but it's nothing what we plan at the moment.
Following up on that question, you showed this blog post with the postmortem of some issues after deploying to buildopensuse.org.
Yeah.
I thought you also had a test instance. So do you not always deploy to the test instance first, see whether that works, and then deploy to buildopensuse,
no,
but directly from Git to production?
Yeah. So we have a test instance, but we do not use it for everything. So, no. It's also sometimes a deployment goes wrong. You deploy code, but you just realize it if you really use it. So, for instance, we had one issue that the RPM lint locks didn't work because we removed the root, or we changed the root, and it was not covered by a test, and we only realized it when we deployed to production and people started using it. And that you also do not realize if you deploy it to the test instance, because then you need to deploy it to the test instance and then you need to use it. And that is just too much work what you want to do before every deployment. You cannot deploy the test instance, build a package and then deploy to production, because then it takes 1 hour deployment or something. So we have a test instance. We also want use it more often, but at the moment we do not use it for everything, or not that we test every commit on the test instance before.
Another question. So OBS in summary is a software and also an OpenSUSE deployment for building software. And you very explicitly were talking about using Travis for actually building your own Git commits. So have you thought about integrating OBS further from GitHub or other services so that it could be used with, you know, showing build feedback also from OBS and not just triggering OBS builds?
No, we haven't researched in this area, but yeah, it's an interesting point. But I think it's still something different, continuous integration and the building. So it's still worth to have both, because you also want to avoid to have everything in the build service, because then it's also the build service also continuous integration. And so, yeah, it's
the background of that question is if we could cover more use cases, then we might get more hardware support for actually the OBS instance.
Yeah.
In particular, thinking of the non-x86 architectures.
Okay. We'll bring that up. So, more questions? I think we are also almost done with the time, so thank you very much.